So right now, I am both an owner of Team Archon and also a professional player playing for Archon. And it is quite different. It's very challenging because back then, when I was in Team Liquid and Root Gaming, I was just focusing all my energy on practicing the game, just, you know, scrimming with other people, doing really well in matches. And now I have to organize, you know, different parts of Archon as well. So it's definitely quite challenging. It's a very delicate balancing act, I guess. I still don't want to suck at the game, obviously. So for personal accomplishments, I feel like anything that's successful will make me happy anyways. So whether that's me you know, performing well in tournaments, or my players performing well, or if Archon holds a very successful tournament and stuff like that. So I got into Hearthstone when I first saw the announcement on, well, when I was playing WoW, right? World of Warcraft. And there was this announcement where the new Blizzard digital card game came to be, and it's in the Warcraft universe. And I love card games, I love Warcraft, so that was an insta sell for me. And I tried really, really hard to get beta key, and once I got a beta key, I was like, yeah, let's just play this. It was really fun. And then my friend went like, yeah, why don't you just try streaming? There's a really great streamer that I watch all the time. And then he showed me Raynad, which was pretty cool. And then, yeah, it just pretty much went from there. I started my stream, and then Root Gaming wanted to pick me up after watching my stream. And then I started joining tournaments. I actually joined one of the Mana Grind tournaments way back then. And I actually won the first one I joined, which definitely helped out a lot, because it also got me into the ESL King of the Hill invites, where I won like 6 out of 8. That was kind of how it all started. And then I started getting invites to multiple stuff. My stream started growing. So I guess I was in the right place at the right spots. You know, RNG again, I guess. So I'm learning a lot as we go along. But esports is definitely a thing that will stick around, right? People are excited, are almost as excited as they are with like sports teams. And I don't know, I love esports. I've been gaming all my life, since I was like, what, grade 3, I had a computer, and then just non-stop playing it. Future of esports is looking pretty bright, in my opinion, as a whole, because there are so many different games. There's the competitive nature as well, which people love, and the accessibility for the public is really, really high, right? So for example, whether you're playing something like League, you know, CSGO, a fighting game, or like Hearthstone, something like that, you can just pick it up and play yourself. So it's looking really good. The viewer numbers are growing a bit, you know, larger and larger. Events are getting bigger and bigger. So we'll have to see what the next big thing is.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to week number 4 of the ESL Hearthstone Legendary Series. Once again, I'm TJ Osmond Sanders. This time, joined with Frodan, the second half of the old Gritorp Frodan duo.
Oh, that's right. I was wondering where you're going with that. That's right. I used to cast with Gritorp back in the day for NESL. In fact, I was doing it 3 years ago, I believe, and it's just time has flown by. I can't believe to see how far Andre and I have come along since then. It's been awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Casting a completely different game now. Still Blizzard, but Hearthstone is quite a bit different from StarCraft.
A little bit. I would say that you need just a little bit less APM to play Hearthstone than you need to play Protoss.
Yeah.
And that's a StarCraft joke, if anyone really gets it. So.
Yeah.
You need about the same amount of hands, though. One hand.
People have been complaining about that for quite a long time. It takes about as much skill to launch off the rocket as it does to force field a ramp.
It's pretty precise, you know. You have to make sure the positioning is absolutely correct. But, well, I'll just let Artosis be the one who flirts the line. I think Gritorp's coming along, too. He's actually played a lot of Hearthstone. Mm-hmm. People don't really know too much about how much he does behind the scenes, but he's trying to play every game at the highest level of proficiency. Diamond in League of Legends.
Yeah.
You know, Legend in Hearthstone. And, of course, Grandmasters in StarCraft, too. Very impressive.
It's a tough feat. It's a tough thing to do.
Yeah.
And, of course, we are moments away from jumping on to the next match. It's going to be Amaz taking on cross7224, or Cross, we can just call him Cross. He's a Japanese player.
Mm. Japanese player. That's
Japanese
really interesting.
Player.
So, you know, TJ, people don't really talk about this much, but the Japanese is the region in Asia for a long time that was proficient in card games outside of Hearthstone. You know, people that looked at, Yu-Gi-Oh!, they looked at Magic the Gathering, they looked at other games and CCGs like that. And in tournaments, you'd always see Japanese players being really high, threats to go really far in the tournament. But more importantly, it's like their style was very unique.
Yeah.
And I'm already looking at the lists here, or the classes, and I already see something that stands out. He's already going to be playing Priest. That already speaks to me, because we're looking at the person who's supposed to be the one who innovated Priest in the first place for the West. That's Amaz. And he doesn't have Priest at all.
Yeah, and Amaz has sort of shied away from that recently, but you talked about it. The Japanese players, even I talked to Cross, he practices a lot with Kornico, who was a player that we saw last week in the Legendary Series, or maybe 2 weeks ago in the Legendary Series. He's also a Japanese player. Mm-hmm. He said they practice a lot together, and they find it really cool that both these players, it's not that big of a scene for Hearthstone yet for the Japanese players. And
yeah, they're still learning the ropes
exactly.
of the game. I believe they're having some fireside gatherings. Nothing to the extent of, what the Legendary mm-hmm. Series is yeah. or a DreamHack. Mm-hmm. Not yet, though. Maybe we can start seeing them come along. It's cool because Japan has dominated other games like the fighting game scene for a while.
Yeah.
But they don't really have too much other claim to fame in terms of the highest viewed games on Twitch. You see Counter-Strike. You see League of Legends. You see Dota. Like, where are the Japanese in that?
Yeah.
Well, maybe you'll see the Japanese start making a run here in Hearthstone. It can start with Cross punching his ticket to the Legendary Series Finals in June 5th and 6th, 7th.
Yeah.
He has to get through Amaz first, though. He's got Hunter and Druid, two classes where it's been hard to remove them from the metagame for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really digging Hunter nowadays, the mid-range Hunter.
Oh, yeah.
I'm really curious to see if Amaz is going to bring that back, because for a long time, Amaz would be playing mid-range Hunter as a class that people kind of wrote off for. That's where he won a tournament. I believe it was the Millennium Cup last year that he won because no one else was bringing Hunter.
Yeah, and now it's starting to make a comeback. I mean, I think one of the big reasons was because it just eats up Freeze Mage. I mean,
sure.
People were bringing Freeze Mage a lot. All of a sudden, Mid-Range Hunter comes and has a really strong matchup against it. And over the first course of the season, I've been playing Mid-Range Hunter a whole lot. I have an 85% win rate over 40 games.
TJ, I heard that you were ranked 4 Legend.
No. I got ranked 9. I was ranked 9 Legend. I was in the first 20. I was the first 25 people to hit Legend this season.
Oh, I see.
But right now I'm like top 100.
Gotcha.
I fell like
dropping.
50 spots.
Gotcha.
Yeah, like right now. Yeah, I just dropped another 10 spots. Because another 10 people.
Well,
because
TJ's laddering while trying to cast, guys. He can't actually multitask that well.
Yeah, I'm trying to play Patron Warrior.
That's why he plays one hero at a time games.
Ouch. Oh, man.
People don't know, but TJ's actually an absurdly talented gamer as well. He's like Challenger League and everything else. So taking a look at it, it's Druid versus Handlock. And more importantly, Cross has missed a turn 2 play of Wild Growth. So, Druid, you want to get ahead on board against Handlock so you can always be pressuring for the kill. Cards like Savage Roar,
yeah.
the Keeper of the Grove, those things really help you punish whatever the Handlock does in response. And if Handlock taps too much, usually you can just kill him from like 17 plus health.
Yeah. It's very true. We saw this matchup they did in the last series. Didn't end too well for the Handlock. But I want to point out one thing here, mm-hmm. aside from the analysis. Notice Amaz's hand is all golden. Now, this gives me a chance.
That's right. No. Even more specifically, the coin.
Which is
golden.
Funny, because I was talking to Cross this week, and he said that he wants to make sure that he tells everyone that he's playing for the free-to-play players. He's a free-to-play player. He never spent a cent.
And he says, way.
Yeah, and he says he wants to show players that you can do well in tournaments.
On NA.
If you're free to play, yeah.
He's playing on NA with free to play account. That's really impressive, mm-hmm. considering that there's also the Asian server. If it's his primary region, then.
I think NA is his primary primary region. But still, it's a feat nonetheless, and it's kind of funny that we're seeing yeah. free to play versus Amaz, who opens like 1,000 packs a week or something.
Right.
Yeah.
Based off his arena runs, which sometimes. Ends up being like disappointing, mm-hmm. but in this case, I'm really curious. Like, what if he has Black Knight because he just straight up doesn't have Cenarius or Sylvanas or something like that? That's pretty amusing. But I think it's really cool what he's representing, what he's trying to do. Now, can he beat one of the most expensive decks in the game?
Mm-hmm.
Outside of Control Warrior, Handlock is pretty high up there. It's got Giants, which are epic. It's got a lot of legendary cards.
Yeah. And for a while, Handlocks were putting in a lot of big threats, too. And it's sort of shied
right.
away from that now. But a lot of times you'd see Dr. Boom, Rag, and even one more big legendary put in there.
Well, it's too bad that one card off from being able to play that Mountain Giant. If you had a full hand on 10 cards, you would have been able to. Can't really consider that a misplay, though. I think Amaz just was going to play the Sun Fury anyways. The key or the mark of a good Handlock player is always being able to tap as much as you can.
Yeah.
Without dying.
Yeah.
Now, here's a tempting thing. Do you want to go for board tempo and play Black Knight, or do you save it because you know that your opponent's going to want to be defensive against you? Now, there's a couple of things that are really interesting. This first thing is a Kodo. What do you think about that, DJ?
I actually really like Kodo, especially with the popularity of Warrior in both forms right now. Being able to get rid of an Armorsmith or an Acolyte of Pain without it getting any draws, like especially against Grim Patron Warrior, who's so reliant on draws, I think it's really strong and out. Another big thing, Imp Gang Boss. Being able to just take out an Imp Gang Boss without proccing a single Imp from the damage is huge. So I really like, I've been experimenting with it in Control Warrior in place of like a second Sludge Belcher.
That's fair enough. But can you rely upon it? It's 5 mana compared to Imp Gang Boss.
It's inconsistent.
What if it hits something and it 1/1 spouts out and you have to make sure you guarantee it? It's really difficult.
Or like if it hits the Cruel Taskmaster in the situation where you want it to hit like an Armorsmith or an Acolyte of Pain. It is inconsistent, but it's something that your opponent may not expect.
Yeah.
And in decks that have room to maneuver with, which I would argue Druid doesn't, because they already have so many cards in the 5 slot that are so good, like Druid of the Claw, Sludge Belcher, Lotheb, Azure Drake.
That's a good point. It's really highly contesting those mana slots. He picks up Savage Roar. So Cross has 11 damage plus 8. That's 19 plus the Hero Power. That's 20. A few points off here, but he can still set up a really powerful tempo swing. Big Game Hunter does leave only 4 mana remaining, which is short of anything else.
Yeah.
But still, I think he should feel very confident with it. And this is what Druid can do against Handlock. And that's why for a long time people were considering Druid to actually be slightly favored against Handlock back when double combo first started appearing commonly. Mm-hmm. Just because how do you deal with this type of pressure relentlessly, considering that you're tapping and lowering your health within range of dying?
Yeah, and also the point against other decks where you're saying, well, I want to get low enough to be able to play Molten Giants but still be safe.
Right.
That threshold against Druids comes so much sooner. Because all of a sudden he has 3 creatures on board or 2 creatures on board. You're at 20 health. You're not in range of Molten Giants, but you're still in range of being able to die next turn. So you have to be able to play defensively while still trying to take control of the board. And
He goes for it.
Okay.
And he's not going to let the Molten Giant Shadow Flame be a play. Now, this is a lot of damage with Savage Roar coming in. We have 7 plus an 8, so it's 15 plus 10. That's 25 damage.
Yeah.
At least.
So it looks like he's going to Sludge Belcher here, which means he's going to be dead. Well, no, actually not, because he doesn't have enough mana to Black Knight Savage Roar.
No, he can just Savage Roar, and he'd still kill him.
Oh, yeah, he'd still kill him.
Because if you Sludge Belcher, he's going to be really tempted. Oh, okay, so he's probably not going to attack because he's too low. If he plays Sludge Belcher, then he effectively gains 7 health. He's at 21. If you play Siphon Soul, you reduce 5 damage and gain 3, so you gain 8 health. Because you'd probably want to Siphon Soul the Lotheb. But here's what the problem is. Like, everything he chooses, I think he dies.
Yeah.
Just because he's just a little bit too short.
Anti-Keelbot, gaining 8 health as well, would still be the same
still
case.
Still be death, right.
Yeah.
I don't think there's an alternative here. And you have to, actually, I mean, this game was played out relatively quickly in terms of some of the decision makings. Handlock is so incredibly technical. He ends up Siphon Souling, but, I mean, that's just still straight-up death. But it's one of those things where Handlock is so difficult to play for this very reason. Like, if you just step a little bit too far, you lose.
Yeah. And, again, you talked about this is one of the reasons why players were saying Druid is favored now, because a lot of times they just win the game.
Mm-hmm.
And Handlock's pro-Handlock players will say they don't like to play against Druids.
Well, here's also another thing, too. There's definitely good ways to build the Handlock, too. There's multiple ways to build the Handlock. And I feel like players are starting to side more towards anti-aggro Handlock.
Yeah.
Because they're starting to see just how punishing the metagame is. You have Grim Patient Warrior, which is what you can normally be good against because you have such big minions. It's very rare that they can get the combo of Warsong off against you. They have to have Commanding Shout.
Yeah.
But the only way to beat Patient Warriors, if you're not going super heavy control, like Freeze Mage or Handlock, is to play a very fast deck. Like, just completely punish them. Mech decks, for example, can just outpace the Patient Warrior. And if you do that and they're starting to flood in, Handlock has to build a little bit more to the anti-aggro aspect. Amaz seems to have a little bit on the heavier side because we saw like Jarrax and Thorazine, but maybe he's not running those new cards. I know some handlocks were experimenting with Demon Wrath, for example. That's one of the new cards. Two damage on the AoE board is okay for three mana, pretty reasonable. But I didn't see that, so.
Yeah, and a lot of times, one of the matchups that Handlock is strong against is Zoo, and a lot of times Demon Wrath can just be a liability against Zoo.
Right.
Because their board is usually flooded with demons. It doesn't really help you. Even though you're already good in that matchup, it can be one of those cards that's a little bit inconsistent. But with Cross taking a victory with the Druid, he's going to move on to, looks like, Priest. So Priest versus Handlock.
Priest versus Handlock is ambitious, to say the least. Now, I want to throw this out there. Before the game starts,
throw it out
TJ.
There. Just throw it.
I've been hearing that Mech Priest is starting to get really popular in Asia.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Were they inspired by Raynad's run through
ladder?
The Play It Cool?
No, but Raynad will definitely say so. Now, in all seriousness, I mean, it's one of those things where, of course, the Chinese would think, or you know, maybe the Asian players in general. But another thing is, too, is I don't know if Cross is necessarily playing that because he knows the Asian scene. I mean, if his primary account is in North America, I mean, he probably just plays a normal Priest, like Control Priest.
Yeah, he told me he doesn't have a team, and he mostly plays, like, Theorycrafts with himself and with Koroniku, who's also main service North America, even though he's a Japanese player, so.
True that.
Resurrect, I saw.
All right, Resurrect with Danger Blade Master, pretty awesome combination.
Yeah.
That's assuming the Injured Blade Master even dies. One of the keys is exactly that. Getting the Injured Blade Master with a Circle of Healing. And it's a really difficult thing because you get the Twilight Drake faster than your opponent. And you might be able to punish the board. Lotheb stops your opponent from being able to go for a big Shadow Flame play. You have the Shadow Ward Death. So I'm kind of liking Cross's position here. Just to start things off, of course, anything could happen as the game develops.
Yeah, the Standard Priest has been historically pretty weak against Handlock. But they've gotten tools recently to get them a little bit more of an advantage. Light Bomb is a big one.
Right.
I'm not sure if this deck would run Light Bomb. Some of the more standard control priests don't run Light Bomb.
Sure.
But with Resurrect, I'm not quite sure if we could consider this a standard control priest.
It's a cool twist. I by the way, I like that Blizzard allowed you to play Resurrect if you haven't had any minions die yet. It's one of those things where, like, sometimes they don't let you play cards if they know the scenario doesn't matter, but it should be on the player to know.
You can resurrect nothing.
Like Oil Rogue, right? You can just oil nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you can't play, like, well, I mean, I guess the targeted spells would be the ones where you can't play them if there's nothing there.
Right.
But since Resurrect
like Deadly Shot, for example, won't let you play if there's no minions on board.
Yeah.
It's like, do they have to make Hunter even that easy? Okay.
And they made all the cards glow yellow, too. I think Hunter is one of the classes that has the most yellow glow cards with Houndmaster and
I'm looking
Kill
at some
Command.
Yellow glow right here on the Priest, man. The Northshire Cleric. I mean, Northshire Cleric with Injured Blade Master seems like to be a really hard thing to pass up this turn. But he chooses not to instead. He plays into Hellfire directly.
That's
ambitious. Because now Resurrect is not guaranteed. You might just resurrect the Shrinkmeister instead.
Yeah.
I mean, the thing about the Northshire is that it would die also to Hellfire, but at least you drew a card and you put the 4/7 on board instead of the 4/3. Now it's like the 50/50.
It's a little bit weird. I mean, I do kind of like you said, protecting the Northshire Cleric, but how many draws are you really expecting out of the Northshire Cleric later on in the game?
Well, you're going to get at least a body on the board for Power Word Shield.
Yeah.
The thing is, he has to weigh his option. Is it really worth trying to go for the 50/50 now with Resurrect? I mean, it's also another question of should he have even played the Shrinkmeister? Should he have held it because he has cards like Shadow Madness and other things in his deck? So maybe he holds on to the Shrinkmeister so that way he can tackle the Twilight Drakes, for example.
Yeah. Later on, though, Resurrect becomes a lot less than a 50-50.
Yeah,
a lot
true,
more risky. Especially if you throw things in there like a Northshire Cleric dying or even smaller things, even like a Recombobulator later on in the game, if this deck runs one.
I mean, all things considered, I think Cross made the right play. I think Shrinkmeister should go down on turn two just to get pressure onto the board. And the Shrinkmeister does make a reappearance, so that Resurrect did not end up paying off too well. But he's still pressing in here, and it's a pretty significant amount of pressure onto the board. That's 8 damage plus the 5 this turn if he chooses to go for it.
Yeah, I think at that point you sort of have to. You can't really afford to play around Molten Giants, even though you don't have a way to deal with it, because priests aren't going to find many opportunities later in the game,
right,
to go for the kill, especially with no cards. I mean, he does a Power Word Shield, he does a Northshire Cleric and Circle of Healing to be able to draw into more and cycle through his deck. But I think applying pressure is one of the ways that priest does win this matchup.
Absolutely. Dark Bomb on the 3-2 instead of the taunt makes complete sense, as it's effectively gaining health for his Drake anyways, and he knows his opponent can't kill him hypothetically unless... Is there a Thought Steal combination that will allow it to get 8 damage for 3 mana?
Overwhelming Arcane Golem. Oh, for 3 mana. Not for 3 mana.
2 Power Overwhelmings. Even though that's absurd to ask for in a hand lock deck nowadays. Mm-hmm. So, they're playing combo lock?
I can
see that.
I've seen some players experimenting with... I've seen actually like 5 or 6 on the ladder in just the past couple of days of either players playing Leroy.
Man, you're putting the time, TJ.
Indeed. Playing way too much Hearthstone is what you really mean. But,
no such thing.
And I've seen a lot of Arcane Golem and Power Woman combinations as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it's making a comeback. You can't really compare ladder, though. It's a competitive play. It's quite a bit different of a meta.
Oh.
But
interesting.
It is making a comeback.
All right, so he's going to opt to go for the Cardra Root. He gets a second Circle of Healing, so that's going to be pretty significant.
The Gilblin Stalker.
Yeah, Gilblin Stalker heavily implies he's playing the Valence Chosen, and the Deathload, of course, is a secondary confirmation. Power Word Shield number 2 on the Cleric just to make sure, but of course, that's no guarantee of anything.
Yeah, so this deck, and the Valence Chosen... Light Bomb, most likely Priest, I think has a lot better of a matchup against Handlock.
Oh, for sure.
Just because you look later in the game when they build up big boards with like Dr. Boom and a Giant or multiple Giants, you just Light Bomb, clears off the entire board.
Multiple Giants, you say?
Indeed. He doesn't have Light Bomb yet, though, so if he even runs it, it's not guaranteed. It's most likely.
Well, I think he also really wants to prioritize stopping this Cleric from drawing cards, and the only way to do is to silence it, because that 1-7 is not going to go down this turn. Wait. The alternative is also just to play Sylvanas, because you know your opponent can't deal with it easily as well. Also, it's a bait for Shadow Word Death.
Mm-hmm. He's already been through one Shadow Word Death, so...
Right.
There hasn't been really any or many tells here that... Cross is running any other variation besides the standard control priest with the Resurrect. Hadn't seen Gilblin, hasn't seen Death Lord.
Yeah, the Resurrect is so interesting, considering that Resurrect is usually more powerful the stronger the minions you have.
Mm-hmm.
If you have an early game curve like Gilblin Stalker, I still have a hard time saying that name, and the Death Lords, how often do you want to Resurrect them? I guess against aggro maybe, but it's essentially just another 2-drop. Wouldn't you rather just play Zombie Chow so that way you have a better target for the Valence Chosen?
Yeah, and in all reality, he might have cut the Zombie Chows in favor. Because this deck, the standard version of this deck, does run Zombie Chow.
Right. I mean, it's an interesting choice for sure. Not to mention that Resurrect is inherently, tagged with RNG.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one of those things where I don't know if it's the most reliable thing for a class that might be a little bit inconsistent already. Are we going to see a lot of cards drawn here? Okay, instead it looks like he's just pacing himself.
Yeah.
Light of the Naru.
This is interesting. This is a pretty interesting deck. The standard Chinese Light Bomb Priest does not run a copy of Light of the Narn at all. So it's sort of like it's his own version, I suppose. Right.
Now, this is something that I think might be that Cross might have to reconsider next time he evaluates. Because if you see Gilblin Stalker, you have to think Light Bomb.
Yeah, yeah.
Before, there weren't any really strong indications otherwise. There's Shrinkmeister, there's Injured Blade Master, even a Resurrect doesn't necessarily ring any alarm bells.
Mm-hmm.
But now you see Gilblin Stalker, so it's like you have to be really cautious not to extend too far out to the board. You already saw a Shadow Word Death, and you have 2 Giants that can be played. But if he drops a Light Bomb, he dunks your board.
Yeah, you want to be at least a little bit conservative with how you play your threats.
A little bit conservative. I mean,
you can afford to play
I'm slapping
risky.
A corset onto this Sylvanas. You cover up that midsection, young lady. That's how I'm going super conservative right now. I'm really scared of a Light Bomb. Amaz is thinking a lot about it. And in fact, we haven't even really discussed about the possibility of plays here. But I definitely am okay with playing a Giant and the Sludge Belcher.
Yeah.
Antique Healbot's also appropriate. It's like less punishing if he has Shadow Madness.
Mm-hmm.
It's unfortunate that this Cleric is still not dealt with. It's just going to draw more cards, which is what the Priest wants to do. If you can keep up card for card, that's reasonable to allow it to potentially win, but it's still a tough matchup.
Yeah. And he's also got to sort of factor in that he doesn't have a life bomb. He hasn't drawn into it yet. So
he's got a lot of chances. I mean, look, he's got so many ways to heal minions.
Yeah. Well, yeah, Holy Nova as well as the Circle of Healing and Light of the Naru. But can he? He can't really damage them enough to the point where the damage he's putting out is actually effective.
Well, it's like a catch-22. It's like you Circle of Healing so Sylvanas doesn't die, but then Sylvanas is still alive.
Yeah, yeah.
And you don't have an answer to it. Mm-hmm. Resurrect, the best minion you can pull up is Lotheb. I guess maybe Injured Blade Master slightly better.
Yeah, so Thought Steal first. Oh.
Ah, that's two of the worst cards you could have asked for in this scenario. Ancient Watcher, what is that going to do?
Nothing.
And what if he resurrects Ancient Watcher?
Anti-synergy. But yeah, it's a lot of players back in the day, Amaz was actually one of them, used to say one of the only ways that Priest can beat Tanlocks back in like the traditional when Amaz used to play Priest was good Thought Steals. Putting more threats available to yourself in your hand. Nowadays, not so much, because they, especially with Light Bomb, they do have ways to be able to deal with it, but he's had very underwhelming Thought Steal.
Sure. Draws one more card. Arcanine Soul Priest picked up. Pretty important. So that way he can use the Circle of Healing as a wipe.
Mm-hmm.
That is an excellent card to pick up, too, considering how big his hand is. Amaz can tap, play Emperor Thorsen, and then just pass. Just let his opponent just deal with his effects.
And having...
Oh, all right. Huh. So Ancient Watcher sets up as a 4-5, kind of like a Yeti.
Yeah.
I think he wants to just take this opportunity to press for the win because Thorsen plus what it's on, plus the Cleric, plus the Molten Giant would not be death.
Well, there's the Light Bomb.
Do you need the Light Bomb, though? I don't think so. You can get away with Arcanine plus Hero Power and the Light of the Naru.
And even have Mortal Coil. You can.
You even have Mortal Coil, you're right. So you can effectively clear the board. I mean, the Ancient Watcher survives.
Nah,
you might even let the... Yeah, you might even let it survive. There's nothing else you can really do about it.
Mm-hmm.
So you Arcanine and then Circle. Hero Power down the Molten Giant. Then you Light of the Naru, the Northshire Cleric.
That's a pretty intense board clear.
Right.
Yep, there's Villains Not Chosen. Bad. I mean, his curve was really weird for how this deck usually likes to play out. But I guess not really for Anlock.
I mean, it looks kind of like the way the Chinese usually build the Light Bomb Priest. The only odd inclusion is the Resurrect. But, I mean, I'm always in favor of fun moments. Resurrect definitely can have potential for some juicy YouTube highlight moments.
That's true. And there's some valuable creatures that deck usually runs as well. I mean, even Pilot of Shredder wouldn't be too bad. A lot of times this deck does run it. Haven't seen one yet, but even that wouldn't be the worst. I mean, that two mana Pilot of Shredder, it's not too bad.
Not too bad at all. Now, Ancient Watcher number two, unfortunately for Amaz, is not that valuable. And because he pressed for the lethal, he doesn't have an opportunity to, like, draw. Like, he didn't have an opportunity to tab last turn, so he's effectively behind one card. That is a great card, though, to pick up. The Mortal Coil effectively allows him to deal with that much less painfully.
Yeah, he's running out of threats, though. I mean...
Amaz?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. His opponent doesn't exactly have threats either. He has... he's going to pull the threats.
Yeah.
I mean, what Deathlords might do effectively is pull the Boombots out of the deck and just pull Dr. Boom onto the board.
Mm-hmm. That's very true.
He's essentially going to summon War Golem.
He could also pull Draxxus, which seems okay, but at the same time...
I just shrink Meister Cabal.
It's possible, yeah.
Steal Draxxus.
And if it pulls Draxxus, you don't have to worry about dealing with the Infernals, because one of the... Draxxus is such a strong card against Priest, because a lot of times you'll be able to safely play Draxxus.
Right.
Because the Priests don't really have much burst. A lot of times they don't have overwhelming board control unless they get it early.
True.
A lot of times you can play Draxxus, just get Infernals out every turn, and the Priest has to find ways to deal with it.
So, would you play Deathlord here on the off chance that your opponent doesn't have a lethal? Because if you play Deathlord and he silences, he already has 8 damage on board, and if he has... He'd be 1 damage off lethal. He'd have a silence on his own. If he had the second owl, he could be 1 damage off lethal.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's like you have to be really careful.
Yeah.
Just trying to think about the possibilities.
He was mousing over the resurrect pretty much the whole turn.
Whoa.
Well,
gets the injured blade master of all things.
I mean, that's like the
that's wild.
Either the second best or the best target that he could possibly have gotten.
He's running out of time, and he doesn't get to play the Death Lord. Oh man.
That's rough. And his webcam is so ominous.
Yikes.
We can't even tell his reaction.
Yeah. That Shadow Flame is a pretty big deal. You can silence one of the Ancient Watchers, attack, and then Shadow Flame. How much damage is this, by the way? It's 12, 15, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Still pretty tight. I mean, as much as Light Bomb is excellent against Giants... if you keep taking like a free shot of the giant here, free shot of the giant there, then you're still in a really tough spot.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I was gonna say, is there any merit to using the Mountain Giant to Shadow Flame and using the Ancient Watcher as your threat?
Yeah, you want to keep the giant as much as possible. The Watcher's not really a threat; it's more of a defensive maneuver.
Yeah. Well, I was saying he could.
I guess he'd be okay with Shadow Flame the 4-1 and then Hellfiring afterwards. Mm,
yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. This puts on
right.
a little bit more pressure as well because the damage. And also, yeah, this is sort of the why I was saying maybe use the Ancient Watcher as a threat because he could have put out a lot more damage during that turn.
Fair enough.
But. I guess in the end it doesn't matter too much unless you're planning to kill him the next turn mm-hmm. anyway. As long as you have enough damage on the board to kill him next turn anyway,
right?
It doesn't matter.
And just look at the consequences of not playing Deathlord. He would have had 8 more health. Another minion would have been on the field. If he pulled the second Molten Giant,
mm-hmm.
The Light Bomb would have been way more effective. The other flip side of it is if he pulled Jiraxxus, he would have been in big trouble.
Yeah.
Because he can't deal with it. He could even pull Dr. Boom, or if his opponent plays Ragnaros or something. There's a lot of threats that you can yank out, and then Light Bomb's way more effective. As a result, now, I mean, Deathlord is cool. He definitely controls the state of the board.
I think Deathlord is super cool.
Oh, yeah.
Deathlord in the late game, I think, is against control decks is really problematic. Against slower decks, I think. Because a lot of times...
For who?
For handlocks, for control.
So you're saying the opponent's in trouble for playing Deathlord against the Deathlord?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Just because a lot of times those late game threats are threats that you are pieces. The threats that are still in your deck are things that you that have really good uses to you as a battle cry or from your mm-hmm. hand. I mean, yeah, it can be good to have a body. Like, say you get like a Shield Maiden if you're playing a Control Warrior, or in this case, you get like a Draxxus. Yeah, it's good to have a body. But the battle cry effect, a lot of times, especially against Priest, is even better. So it's the Deathlord can cause a lot of problems for a 3-drop late in the game.
It's so tight. Look at their health counts. If just one of them had Ragnaros, I mean, if Amaz had Ragnaros, he'd win already because he'd just shoot him in the face.
Indeed.
If I had Ragnaros and I played on this field, it would somehow hit my own Deathlord and summon his Ragnaros.
And then it would hit you in the face.
And then it hit me in the face, and I lose.
Yep. Sounds about right. I don't play Rag for that exact reason. So how does he get through this turn?
So he has a Valence Chosen play.
Mm-hmm.
Question is if he wants to play the Aconite with it and potentially just die. Because if his opponent, like, gets, like, a Molten Giant Shadow Flame.
Or breathes the
it's
wrong
like,
way.
He's dead. Siphon Soul is so big. Wow.
Oh, man.
Oh, man. If this summons something huge from the deck.
Doesn't even matter. You can kill him anyway.
Oh, a Molten Giant. And he already uses it. Oh, he already has lethal, of course.
Yeah.
Dark Bomb.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Forgot about the Dark Bomb there. So that's going to be it. And Amaz wins game number 2 and ties it up.
All right.
The removal on the Death Lord. You cashed in a little bit too hard onto it. He should have spread out. So that way it was 2 Death Lords.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, then you keep up the Sludge Belchers. You're still weak to that Shadow Flame play.
Yeah.
So overall, you know, he weighed his scenario, and I think the Valence chosen play was the better one.
Yeah, I think some of that comes down to that turn where you mentioned he wanted to put out that Deathlord but didn't have time. He broke out.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That could have saved him eight health.
Should have been out for a while.
Yeah, and whatever was pulled from that, I mean, if it was Molten Giant like we saw there at the end,
right,
which was pretty likely.
I thought he was going to Molten Giant, and then, like, it wouldn't really have mattered because he had the Dark Bomb to kill, but if he didn't, it's like, that point, you need Shadow Word Death or you lose no matter what. Mm-hmm. So it's like, at that stage, it's really risky to have Death Lords just putting it out, and that's why... You know, as much as you were saying, it's still tough for control players sometimes to handle it. I think in the end, control players don't mind having their big threats being pulled.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes.
Sometimes. Yeah. A lot of times it just ends up pulling like your Iron Beak Owl, and you're just like, what?
Yeah. Or it pulls your Alexstrasza, which you were going to use like, to kill him, and then it gets light bombed anyway.
Deathlord is just like a lot better version of Hungry Dragon. It's like, what? Yeah. Yeah. So I guess that wraps up game two, and we're tied. Guys, we're in group stages, by the way. So whoever wins two series advances to day two, going into the semifinals, but only one player goes to the LAN.
Yeah, and of course, everybody else, though, will have a chance in that redemption tournament, which actually happening next week. So all the players that lose will get another chance.
I'm seeing if I can make it, TJ. I'm trying to fit it in, but maybe I can come back. Can't get rid of me that easily.
I'll just get a giant cardboard cut out of you and talk to it.
Even though you gave me a black eye, you can't get rid of me that easily, TJ.
Did I really?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
It's not his fault, guys. He loves me.
Yeah. It was dark in the room last night. I couldn't really tell exactly what I was doing.
That got dark really fast. That got dark really fast.
That's what she said.
That's what my eye says. Jeez.
All right. Well, Cross still has Priest left. He still has Warrior left as well. And Amaz.
Oh, dang. We've got Warrior versus the Hunter. Now... This might be the matchup. If you saw this about a month ago, you'd be like, oh, great. Control Warrior versus Face Hunter.
Freeway.
Does he get the Armor Smith? You know, that kind of thing.
It's a lot more intricate nowadays.
But now it's like, is it Mage Hunter versus Grim Patron Warrior?
Mm-hmm.
Is it Mech Warrior that Live Coach busted out a couple weeks ago versus the Hunter, the Control Hunter that we saw fake play at Gfinity?
Is it Hobgoblin Warrior?
Wow.
You know, Hobgoblin Warrior actually became a thing for a little bit?
Just because you play it doesn't make it a thing, TJ.
Well, I'm a big part of the the competitive Hearthstone
legend pool.
Weird.
Yeah. You're one of the 100 legends right now.
Is there? There's got to be more than that.
You're part of the 125 legends right now.
Yeah, there you go. That's pretty much it. But, so it does make it a thing when I actually play Hobgoblin Warrior. But, no, you could put Hobgoblin in Mech Warrior, and it actually works. Like, you use Hobgoblin as an additional threat.
TJ, stop trying to make Hobgoblin Warrior
works.
A thing.
There was people that were playing it in an obscure country in Asia on the Asian servers.
Obscure country in Asia?
Yeah.
That sounds...
I'm just
remotely
grasping.
Believable for I'm a card game.
Yeah, I'm just grasping. Yeah, I mean, you talked about Mech Priest earlier. Which one is hard? Which one is easier to believe, Mech Priest or Hobgoblin Warrior?
Mech Priest.
That's easier
for
to believe.
For sure, they have such a sick card. The upgrade repair bot is a 5/5 plus 4 health.
Warriors have access.
Are you insane?
Warriors have access and natural synergy with so many one attack creatures. The Warbot, Acolyte of Pain, Armor Smith.
Those are the only three.
It's a natural fit. Okay. Well, I didn't even see the mulligans here because I was so passionate about my love
for... Well, Amaz is playing the mid-range Hunter.
Yeah.
Looks like it. Unless he's playing Sludge Belcher and Face Warrior inexplicably.
And that's Grim Patron War.
And it's a Grim Patron War. We saw the Gnomish Inventor, which was one of the key cantrips.
Yeah.
Now, the important thing for the mid-range Hunter is to be able to out-tempo your opponent and really hope that they don't have card draw.
Yeah.
When I first started learning Patron Warrior... I always thought that Midrange Hunter was one of my best matchups. Mm-hmm. This was before it even got refined to the state it is now. Like, people weren't playing Armor Smiths in it. And Armor Smiths already helps a lot, considering that Midrange Hunter can sometimes just outpace you and then punish you really hard.
People don't really know that you were the first competitive Hearthstone player to play Grim Patron Warrior in a tournament.
And they'll never know, TJ, because no one cares.
Well,
the thing is, it kept getting banned. Everyone's like, Ferdinand's playing Control Warrior at Seed Story Cup. It's like, well, I don't want to play Control Warrior. I brought Freeze Mage, so I'm just going to ban it. I'm like, no! I'm playing Patient Warrior. They're like, nice try, Ferdinand. No one plays Patient Warrior. I did a card review with four other pros on a talk show, and I said it was bad. So it is bad.
It's true that pretty much everybody said that maybe good in arena.
No, that's not. That's also a little bit unfair. There's a few players that said it was like pretty good. It's just that they didn't include it into the montage.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, it's less funny.
Confirmation bias.
Ooh, Direwolf Alpha. That's interesting, considering that it allows him to trade into this without, because you know normally you're afraid of the bow, the mm-hmm. Eaglehorn bow to cash in. But
there's been some mid range hunter players who actually put in Direwolf Alpha as an actual card in the deck.
That's right, Era from Team Root,
and also Death Star.
Two great hunter players.
Yeah, two great hunter innovators as well. I mean, Direwolf Alpha has a great synergy with a lot of things that you're going to put in. Mm-hmm. Haunted Creepers, Unleash the Hounds. It can be really, really strong.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes as a mid-range hunter, you just need a body to put earlier. You don't have as many early drop bodies. And even if it just allows you to trade like one of your Haunted Creeper spiders into something a little bit bigger, I mean, that's a victory. You get a little bit stronger of a board presence. Allows you to put out those sticky cards like Piled Shed or Savannah High Main.
Sure.
All of a sudden, you're in a really good spot.
Does the model need to coin this turn? I mean, Coin Sludge Belcher is pretty strong considering your opponent doesn't have Deathbite out, but if your opponent does have Deathbite in hand and he's on 4 mana, then you're in trouble. So he goes instead for a Freezing Trap play.
Yeah.
And he waits. Now, this still can be interpreted as Snake Trap because Snake Trap has been cycled in once again just to confuse opponents. And this is a little bit unfortunate for Cross. You know, you want to get these Acolyte, the Whirlwinds, the Battle Rages.
Yep.
Even like, you know, just anything that draws whatsoever. The Gnomish Inventor, that's what you want to be playing. These are his finishing cards.
Yeah.
These are his win conditions. 3 out of the 4 win conditions. The only thing missing is Grim Patient Warrior.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, the 5th win condition is TJ controlling it.
Exactly. I've been playing a whole lot of Patient Warrior lately, actually.
You just said you were playing a lot of Hunter.
And Patient Warrior.
Oh. Okay.
Those are the two decks that I use.
Which do you love more, TJ? Choose now.
Patient Warrior, hands down.
Okay.
Hunter, I was just trying to learn, because I've never played much midrange Hunter. Those were the two decks that I used from like rank 5 to Legend.
Wow, that wasn't even hard for you. I thought you were going to agonize and like ask if you had to.
Oh, you know my...
And
my,
then do like the, you know, the life flashbacks.
My never-dying love for Warrior will...
You know, the Titanic theme music. Choosing between Hunter and Warrior.
No, but I mean, a lot of times in Grim Patron War, you in your mulligan, you just look for cards that draw. Like, you look for... against Hunter, it's
combo
like...
Combo decks in general.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Just want it.
Yeah.
All right, so Freezing Trap. So then just ends up going for the taunt once again. Mm-hmm. Buys Amaz a little bit of time, and in the end, practically nothing changed about the board state.
Yeah.
Except Amaz lost a coin, and the Armorsmith lost the health.
So I want to get your opinion on this. Just your raw opinion. What deck do you think is the favorite in this matchup?
Oh, I think the Patron Warrior, man.
Okay.
Just because in the end, it's really difficult for you to not play minions that have more than 2 attack. The mm-hmm. Patron will, or the Grim Patron will collect value. The matchup goes long enough, too, because Midrange Hunter sets up as opposed to rushes.
Yeah.
So even if you do get to that point, they have a likelihood of drawing cards into Execute to take care of your High Main. Like, High Main's actually not that big of a deal if you have Execute, because you Execute and then combo with Patron, and then Patron just kills the 2/2s and spawns more Patrons.
Yeah.
It's like, what's your AoE clear? Your AoE clear is to use Leash to Hounds and Knife Juggler. It's like, you're going to shoot more Patrons down. Now, that's, of course, in the ideal scenarios. Mm-hmm. Some of the less favorable scenarios is like this. You get no card draw. Any minion you play on board can get shut down by a weapon, and he pushes for damage. And one thing that Grim Patron Warrior does very poorly compared to other decks is climb back from deficits when they have low health against a deck that pressures them.
Yeah.
Because just like any other combo deck that's oriented on drawing, like Combo Warlock or something like that, those decks have a lot more heal, and this deck practically has none outside the Armorsmith. So if he's at like 14 health because he keeps trading, like say he draws Deathbite, he's just going to be in trouble because he's going to be trading too much of his health.
Yeah. I agree with you. And I have data to sort of prove that you are limited amounts of data. But
is your IQ over 140?
I've actually talked to quite a few players, and a lot of players actually side with the Hunter.
Really?
It was a surprising amount of players that said mid-range Hunter is actually the favorite.
Okay. Maybe that's how they feel like, because they're playing a lot of good Hunter games.
Yeah.
And winning.
A lot of them nodded towards the fact that the mid-range Hunter has a lot more consistent openings.
where the Grim Patron Warrior
has a lot
more inconsistent openings. And a lot of times, if the midrange hunter has a good opening and the warrior has a bad or mediocre opening, the midrange hunter can just close out the game.
That's true. Midrange hunter can be a lot more consistent.
Yeah, yeah. That's one of the things that people said. But there are those pros, like Modern Leper, actually. He said if you don't bring he's one of the players we saw earlier. He said Grim Patron Warrior is hands down the strongest deck right now. And if you don't bring it, you're dumb.
Do you say it with a southern accent?
No, he's
like
actually
that?
From the UK. I just added that in for flair.
So if you don't bring it, you're a tosser?
a wanker.
A bloke.
I don't even know how bad these insults are on a UK scale.
I don't know either. Like, we could be swearing for all we know.
Yeah, we could be being the most obscene Americans you could possibly imagine, but...
Okay. I was, like, confused by the positioning. I was like, does he not want to...
That basically
buff his own tack, but makes sense. Fiery War Axe unfortunately comes a little bit too late. Like, that would have been really good to control the state of the board. Oh, sorry, never mind. He had Fiery War Axe. I meant the Death Spite. He wanted that to be a Death Spite so that way he could be controlling the state of the board.
Yeah.
But now it's a little bit awkward. And the Midrange Hunter has gained enough presence on board where it's going to start hitting hard.
Yeah. Death Spite really is the most important card in Grim Patron Warrior deck, in my opinion.
It's one of. I mean, I would argue Grim Patron Warrior is also one of the most important cards in Grim Patron Warrior.
I think you can win games without Grim Patron Warrior, but you can't win games without Deathbite. Is the way I look at it.
Wow. That's right. What about Warsong Commander, if it was missing from your deck?
Yeah, okay. Warsong Commander also on par. But, like, you can... Deathbite is also necessary for you to not lose games. Whereas Warsong Commander... Or for you to...
Not
lose games. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
It's your main win condition, also your main not lose condition, if that makes any sense. Probably not.
It does. Okay. It's just, you know.
One guy out there is like nodding his head at his computer. Mm-hmm. Asmo's right. I'm going to tweet it.
That's me. I'm nodding right now. I'm looking at a computer.
Alrighty.
All right. So Dr. Boom could pull something back, but this is what we talked about from the beginning. Cross has no card draw. So he is just running out of supplies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's very true.
And these Boombots need to have... it's almost coming down to the point where the Boombot has to hit the Pilot Shredder and then a Doomsayer comes out. It's like almost getting to that desperation moment because you're just taking way too much damage. And Lotheb coming down is so massive because you can't use Battle Rage. You can't use... Well, I guess you could use Battle Rage. It's just going to cost you your entire turn.
It gives you, like, a free turn is essentially what it does.
Yeah.
And, I mean, first Boombot.
Right.
Not really. I mean, that's pretty effective, being able to take out the Knife Juggler, but is it
Well, this was a really significant draw, I think. The Grim Patron. I mean, we're in business, man. If this Boombot can do what it needs to get done and, like, snipe one of those minions, if something with less than 3 attack comes out of that Pilot Shredder... And he manages to kill it. I mean, we're in business, boys.
We are.
But it's like we said, he took a lot of damage.
Yeah. Whatever comes out of this Pilot Shredder, I think, is going to be a huge deal. And also where this Boombot damage goes.
Right. Because the Lotheb's still around.
Yeah. I mean, that Grim Patron could not have come at a better time. Because what if he didn't have that there? He would have, had to throw in the Frothing Berserker to try and relieve some of the pressure?
So he wants to return the Boombot back to his hand.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a Snake Trap! Oh, he can't attack with Grim Patron anymore!
That's rough.
Well, I guess he could, but he would activate it, and then his board would be filled up, so it wouldn't matter.
That's not a draw that you want to see at this stage.
Right. Well, I mean, it's interesting because normally you don't mind Snake Trap because it spawns 1/1s.
Yeah.
But just this board is full, so like right now it doesn't actually do much. It actually increases power onto the board.
Yeah.
And if you increase power onto the board, you take too much damage, you lose.
Yeah, our spectator mouse over Snake Trap. Just to let us know that it is not Snipe. Thank you very much.
That's right.
Snipe.
And those are the only possibilities. Misdirection would have backed.
Yeah. Snipe is a great secret when nobody expects Snipe.
That is interesting. Okay, so the Ironbeak Owl. Huh. Well, you obviously want to deal with a lot of things here. People always confuse what they should target first. Like, should I kill all the patrons? But they always forget that the Warsong is what also really engines it behind. Yeah. gives it all that steam. So, you know, personally, I'm a big fan of just killing off the... Or maybe killing off or silencing or something. Like, dealing with the Warsong Commander first.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's definitely a high priority. Mm-hmm. Amaz recognizes that immediately.
Yeah. And this Lightwell could prove problematic. The one thing, though, is he doesn't have... Once this Lilithep is dealt with, Cross deals with the Hunter Hero power every turn.
Right.
It basically negates it. So he's going to have to find a way to win with a board. And right now, it feels like he's lost a board.
Well, kind of. I mean, the fact that this Grim Patron can't copy itself yet, but it can get replayed is big.
Yeah.
You can actually even make an argument that Amaz maybe shouldn't have played his Freezing Trap. But you can understand why.
Mm-hmm.
Just because he doesn't want to take too much damage.
But, yeah.
It's one of those scenarios where if he has 9, 10, 9, 12, if he had Grommash in inner range, he would have lost. So this would... does this still doesn't stop? I don't know.
Well, it gets a Boombot back.
I think it does stop it, yeah.
Huh. I would think he'd want the Grim Patron back.
Right.
But
it's okay, because he's keeping Grim Patrons onto the board. He's spawning a new one.
Yeah.
And there's the Grommash. Like, this, I mean, Midrange Hunter grabbed the board so early, and now it looks like he can't do anything to win. He's so far away from victory.
Yeah. I do think one of the, he hasn't drawn into one of the key cards in this matchup, though, and that is the Savannah High Main. I mean, that's Midrange Hunter's key card in most matchups.
Sure.
It's actually pretty tough to remove, because you have to spend a turn removing it, and then you have to, like, you can't remove it and combo with Grim Patrons on one turn unless it's really late in the game.
It's fair. Dude, I mean, Amaz did a really good job setting up the board initially, but it looks like he's just getting pummeled by the Patron Warrior.
Yeah, he's out of steam. Out of steam.
Oh, the High Main.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's so funny is you kill off that Patron, but it just means that your opponent has one less damage. He gains two from the Frothing Berserker.
Yeah.
And that should be lethal, right, if he picks up an Activator?
13, 19. Yeah, it's not quite with...
It's close.
Is there a way that he can do it by attacking in?
Yes. I think if he just keeps trading in the Grim Patrons, right?
Yeah.
Should he be able to get it? Because it's two damage every single time, so
yeah.
He attacks. But he doesn't get charge.
Yeah.
So he's only going to have...
No, I think it would have been the same amount of damage either way. This way he puts himself in a better board state, though. So,
okay.
Either way...
Oh, my God.
Amaz is just top decking, so there's not a card that's going to save him.
That was insane. Do have to note that Amaz got a pretty good drop off of the Pilot Shredder. It's not something that can get copied.
Yeah.
It's got enough health to withstand a Grim Patron, so it doesn't nullify its attack. It does nullify the attack.
Mm-hmm.
It also heals, so it gives him some time. He would have lost it a little bit earlier, but...
Yeah.
Wow, what an interesting set of... games that we have. I think game number three just shows you perfectly of why, I feel that Grim Patron Warrior is great against Midrange Hunter.
I agree with you.
He didn't even draw well. Like, he drew pretty poorly, all
things
considered.
No card draw. We saw one Acolyte of Pain, I think, and it was in his hand at the end of the game.
Right, and he had Dr. Boom from the very early get-go,
yep.
Didn't have Death's Bite, no Whirlwinds to deal with the 1-1s. Off the web spinner, Amaz got Direwolf Alpha to help him trade.
Yep.
So, like, I think things went generally favorably for Amaz up until the point where the Patron was drawn, and then he couldn't deal with it effectively afterwards. It's like we were talking about. How do you actually deal with the Grim Patron if you're the Midrange Hunter?
I mean,
so what do you think, DJ?
As most classes, how do you really deal
with
it?
So what do you think, DJ? Who's favored in this matchup?
I said it earlier.
Oh, you agreed with me.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah, yeah.
Good.
I was just saying there was some players that I talked to.
I'm a person that works off affirmation, DJ.
Yeah.
A lot of compliments go a long way from me.
Finn, your analysis earlier was spot on.
Thank you, DJ.
And it matched my data, too, that I collected over the week from playing both matchups on either side.
You surpassed your Mensa. I believe it.
All right.
Druid versus Priest. This Priest has to win a game. That's the big question. But against Druid, I think, is one of the classes that definitely is doable.
Yep.
Priest against the Druid. If it goes the way of the Druid, Amaz has to win Hunter versus Priest. That's interesting.
Yep.
It pretty much goes to whoever can seize the board in this matchup, because the injured Blade Master with a Resurrect can be super hard for Druid to deal with. Now, on the opposite end, if Druid innervates out Thorson and Priest doesn't have Shadow Ward Death. It's like, well, that was fun.
Game
but
over.
Not really. You die to a combo turn 7.
Yeah. So I really like this matchup, but I'm not 100% sure how Cross's deck does compared to the more standard
it does great Chinese Light with Bumpers. That hand.
That hand's really great.
That hand is... Like, yeah. He just needs a Northshire Cleric, and that hand's the nuts.
So Dan actually played in the Legendary Series Week 4 Challenger Cups over the weekend.
Did you? How far did you get?
Round of 64. So, I did okay.
Out of, like, 700 players?
Yeah.
Pretty good, dude.
I ended up losing to Jason Zhu, who was a...
Jason Zhu?
Zhou. Z-H-O-U. He was a number 9 so, legend in the April season. So you know how they just release the rankings? He's number 9. And he went on to lose against the eventual winner.
Modern.
Domdus was that day.
Oh, okay.
So I can take solace in the fact that, in a weird way, I lost to the eventual winner. Right. But I actually brought Lightbron Priest as one of my decks. I streamed it. So it was like 20 people that watched. But I streamed my way through. So, and I was eating Druids alive with Lightbron Priest.
Druids generally, like, they play the 5/5s, right? The Ancient of Lores. But, this load that was so high impact because Cross can't play the Injured Blade Master and combo it.
Yeah, and he can take out this Death Lord.
That's so scary because of the possibility of Wrath.
Yeah.
Savage Roar? Let's see. Hold on. You really want to kill off that Injured Blade Master for the implications of what it could lead to. You also want to kill off this Death Lord, too.
Savage Roar is so awkward.
It is, because there's not 5 mana.
Yeah.
And you want to save Innervate for probably like 5 Sludge Belchers, 6 Ragnaros?
Yeah. Because right now, everything you do is just really awkward. You Innervate, then you can push out Sludge Belcher and Zombie Chow.
You Savage Roar, and then you hit with the Shade into it, and then your Hero Power, and then the Lotheb goes into, what's it called? The Injured Blade Master. It's just that you take a lot of damage on your minions, so that Holy Nova wrecks you.
Yep.
Wow.
That's not too bad. 4/4s are really tough. Not for Light Bomb.
Also, when do you see a Druid of the Claw just played without transforming? I mean, the Druid of the Claw is one of the biggest role players in the game.
I would expect him to just be naked.
It's kind of weird.
Yeah.
Not seeing him
naked
take on or roleplay.
I'm surprised he's not naked, actually. Where does his clothes go when he transforms?
I mean, it's kind of like the big mystery of every TV show I've ever watched.
Yeah. Oh, I'm a bear. My clothes are gone.
Like, Ash Ketchum is like 19 years old. He's been traveling since he's like 10. And he's still wearing, like, the same pairs of clothes.
Yeah. He's basically Gary Coleman.
God.
Essentially
of course,
the same
like,
story.
Actual, of course, like, Pokemon enthusiasts everywhere would be like, no, in Season 7, when they entered the Kanto or the Johto region, he changed his outfit because his mom gave him a new pair of underwear. And it's like, oh, thank you for letting me know.
What you talking about, Pikachu?
Oh, my God. Wow.
All he needs to do is
Brock saying that?
All he needs to do is run for governor of California. And then we've come full circle.
There's no Light Bomb to deal with this board. Would have been excellent.
And the board is very scary.
Yeah, he actually dies to a second Savage Roar. So this game looks like it could end really quickly, solely because, like we said, the Innervates onto the early board was just too much.
Mm-hmm.
It realistically could just end here. He needs a Thought Steal, like a Wrath onto the Sludge Belt, not Sludge Butcher, the Shave Next Rams.
Well, would you look at that?
Yeah. Or maybe, yeah. You. I was thinking about, like, Wrathing for one so you draw a card, but can drawing a card really help that much? I guess if you want to just Light of the Nara yourself so you don't die, because there's going to be at least 14 damage on board, or 15 damage.
Yeah.
If you, if you only Wrath for one, because he gets the Hero Power. Also, it's going to be a scenario where I think you just rag, right? 50-50 to win the game.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, this sets him up in... he takes as much power off the board, the same amount that he would have with the Shadow or Death,
right.
But this way he he's able to bring himself a little bit out of range.
Oh, he's not 50-50. He's a 33% chance to win the game.
Yes, with the light ward in there.
Right.
Ah.
Okay, so just put pressure anyways. Amaz going for the safe rag play. That ain't Amaz. But it's okay. It's the point where he's pressured so much. Hitting the phase, hitting the minion is both equally acceptable in this scenario.
Well, resurrect. You could get a Death Lord.
Yeah, he could.
But
get
it's
a
not
going to
block enough damage. It so won't matter. Concede.
Yeah, the priest versus druid. This was a stomp, to say the least.
Yep. Yeah, that was really rough. And I mean, he's still got to find a win with that priest, and it's going to be against Hunter.
Yeah, so the priest versus Hunter is also very early board oriented, partially because the Northshire Cleric and drawing cards is like the paramount importance.
Yeah.
There's so many answers on the priest side to shut down that Hunter. You get the Shadow Madness on anything that's Houndmastered, and you just like, you know, wipe him out. Because if he Houndmasters the Haunted Creeper or the Web Spinner, you're able to get the value. If you get the Shadow Word Death and the Holy Nova, you can deal with the High Mains. If you get the Cabal Shadow Priest, you can pretty much take anything with Shrinkmeister. So it's a very good matchup on paper. But sometimes it just doesn't pan that way. So I'm looking at a Northshire Cleric early draw to get those cards and seize the early game tempo and card advantage.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And we saw earlier how Amaz's Hunter ran out of steam against the Warrior. And it's sort of a similar position against the Priest. Priests, ideally, like you said, on paper, have so many ways to deal with everything that the Hunter can do. And if they're doing that efficiently and have a chance to draw early on, to draw into those answers and have a better card engine, sort of, then, again, the Hunter's going to run out of steam.
God, what is that hand from the Hunter? Jeez. Throw it all away.
Immediately.
That's right. I want to see those cards ever again. Well, Freezing Trap can be really great, honestly. It just depends. Your curve is so much more valuable.
Yeah. This.
Yeah, double knife juggler is pretty reasonable. But then you just get stopped by Death Lord, right?
Yeah, you think about it, though. I mean, what else does a mid-range hunter have? They have knife jugglers, web spinners, haunted creepers. Are like all their.
Fair enough. Mad scientist.
Oh, yeah, mad scientist as well. That's a good point.
Oh, man. If he plays his Gilvan Stalker, so he wants to try to catch his opponent off guard, but that gives him time. Oh, that's a great draw. If that was Misha, oh man, if that was Misha, that would have been like, say goodbye to the game, because he would have just ran, like he wouldn't do anything, he plays Death Lord, he kill commands, pushes, you know, he gets good trades.
Yeah.
Now it's still kind of open.
If he Death Lords here and trades into the Knife Juggler, what is Amaz going to have to kill command the Death Lord in order to push through? You can't let that Death Lord sit. Because, eventually you just keep throwing minions at it. You want to kill it one fell swoop so they don't get any value out of healing it.
So, Animal Companion here is interesting, but Pilot Shredder is like the better, better play on.
If you Pilot a Shredder, you're giving up your Leoc. Pretty much for free.
Yeah, well, you're getting a what's it called? The Web Spinner also collects. You know what? It's fine. He's attacking face. He doesn't have a good trade, so it's like screw it.
Yeah.
He's gonna let him attack into it. Plus, I think he's considering that my opponent would play. He would play only something with two mana because of the hero power is gonna consume it. He doesn't want this to drop, so he's gonna have to heal it, right? Of course, he's not accounting for something like Light of the Naru with Death Lord and then shutting that down.
He's got a Power Shield thrown in there as well.
Here's another thing, too. Does Amaz have a Hunter's Mark in his deck? Because I know a lot of mid-range hunters have enjoyed putting it in there.
And I'd say in like 90% of mid-range hunter decks, one copy of Hunter's Mark is.
Because here's an easy way for things to go absolutely awful. He plays Death Lord, he Hunter's Marks it, he attacks it, and then a High Main comes out.
Yeah.
He does have Shadow Word Death and a Light Bomb, but it's like you just lose so much tempo onto the board.
Yeah. The amount of creatures in the mid-range hunter is actually It's relatively limited.
Right.
They have a lot of, like, Animal Commander's not a creature, it's a spell. Mm-hmm. Then they have a lot of, like, traps and, like, kill commands, quick shots, wow. like, small spells like that. So pulling out a Savannah Highmaid from Deathlord is actually relatively likely.
So he goes instead for the heal and the buff on the health.
Just a really strong, creating a really strong board.
So he's baiting out as much of the removal now, so that way he doesn't have to deal with it later when the Deathlord drops. He's just trying to maximize it. Freezing Ooh. Trap almost certainly to come out here.
Animal Companion into Freezing Trap and a shielded mini bot from the Powder Shredder. That's one of the wow. best that you can get.
It is so efficient. Now, of course, it is weak to the Cabal Shadow Priest because he has the coin.
Not with a Leok, but I guess you would just steal the
Leok. Yeah, steal the Leok.
Not bad either.
Which is even better, I'd say. Yeah, this is...
I don't know. Would you rather have a half lion, half bird, or would you rather have a robot?
Is he half lion, half bird? I just thought he was a straight-up monkey.
No, isn't it supposed to be like Leok is like a lion hawk or something? Like, that's what they call it, Leok?
Then what's Misha?
A female bear.
A miniature geisha? Those are the only two words I could think of that mash up into Misha. I think he's just a monkey. Looks like Rafiki from The Lion King. He's holding up Simba.
I don't know what to say to that, TJ.
Oh my god, unleash the hounds! That is so sick! He gets buffed by the Leok.
That
and
is ridiculous.
He just gets three juggles! And what if this web spinner picks up like a, what's it called, a Stone Tusk boar, and just like, and just like completely shuts down this board.
No, two juggles to phase is not that exciting.
No.
But!
He can still clear everything off. And yes. of course, check with the web spinner first. See what he gets. King of Beasts. That's actually
a lion.
That's definitely a lion, yeah. Savannah Hyman's also a lion. It's not
just any lion, it's Scar.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think he wants to hit this Leok into the Deathlord so that way he can take care of the rest of the board, right? Or is he just going to ignore and go face?
He's already put on so much pressure at this point. He's got a kill command in his hand.
Ooh. Another web spinner. Okay. So he's just going to... Oh, that's right. He has a freezing trap, so he can still isolate.
Yeah.
That's a much better play then.
Dude, that light bomb would be sweet if it actually did anything.
It kills the knife juggler and the web spinner. That's it.
Yeah, so it does nothing effectively.
It does nothing, yeah.
It gains him a little bit of health. The web spinner replaces itself. And here's also an amusing thing. If he doesn't do anything... One, he's dead. But two, the King of Beasts comes out as a 4/6, right? Because it gains +1 for each beast in your field.
Yeah.
And there's two beasts, so that's going to be a 4/6 taunt. It's like Drew the Claw.
And that's weird. In a way, like King of the Beasts is like a really weak Drew to the Claw. Because you have to have...
It's like, well, which would you rather have? A shape-shifting bear or a lion?
You're going to... What if I say lion? Are you going to tell me I'm wrong?
No, it's just that the Drew of the Claw can be a cat as well. Like, it's a lion and a bear.
Yeah, I'm still just a little bit upset about the Drew of the Claw, though.
No.
I just don't know where its clothes go.
Keep your eye on the prize, TJ. We're almost there. Light Bomb gains him a little bit of health, but Kill Command just finishes it out. So Amaz is going to win the series 3-2.
Really
and
close.
The last game was not even close,
Mm-mm.
but a lot had to do with whether or not Cross got that early start. And you have to wonder, is Priest good to bring to a tournament, TJ?
He actually, all through the game, said he lost.
The King of Priests.
Good pun.
Didn't even bring Priest.
I know.
Amaz is supposed to be, you know, the conqueror of all things of the light. And he didn't even bring the Priest class to the tournament.
Yeah. Well, he's been bringing Hunter a lot.
He's been bringing Hunter. Handlock was a deck that he also played a lot. In fact, his lineup is almost similar to what he did in his first premier tournament appearance, which was DreamHack Bucharest. He brought... it was best of three, so unfortunately he didn't get to show his third deck, but he brought Handlock and he brought Hunter.
Yeah, yeah.
Those were the classes he brought.
And it's been sort of a trend mm-hmm. for a long time for him with those couple of classes.
That's right.
But, of course, we saw Cross... all games that he lost were against Priest, so he will move on to the loser's match to mm-hmm. face Modern Leper. Of course, Amaz... we'll move on to face Luigi's later on. But
even
the player that loses will have another chance. We should take a moment to go over the Redemption Tournament once again. That'll be happening
later this week. So May 14th, 15th, 16th, and 17th. Everybody.
It's a four-day broadcast each.
Indeed. I'm looking forward to it. I've had actually a couple four-day broadcasts over the past couple weeks. So it's really fun to sort of see. It's going to be a separate seven-player bracket every single day. The winner of each bracket makes it to that Season 2 LAN Finals to compete for $25,000. It's going to be 16 players at that LAN Finals.
16 players,
16.
Some fun stuff being planned. Colento and Life Coach already got their spots with Kabi from South America. So cool stuff. And the Redemption Tournament gets four more players from players like Savitz, who didn't make it. Trump's going to make a comeback. Of course, a lot of people saw Strifeco playing in week one. He didn't make it, but he gets a chance to play in it. I'm looking forward to it. California's an awesome time. And we don't have enough American-based events. So generally speaking, I'm in favor of seeing more players come over here to this side of the Atlantic, because too many people make us go to Europe.
Indeed.
Getting tired.
Yeah, I know. You've been going back and forth over the past month and a half, so I'm sure you're happy to have that in America. But our next match, of course, is going to be that loser's matchup for Group 8. It's going to be Modern Leper versus cross7224. That match, plus many more, the Hearthstone Legendary Series return.